Welcome to Building the Future. I'm your host, Kevin Horick. You can check out new episodes of the show every Tuesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. If you missed an episode or want to get more information about the show, please visit buildingthefutureshow.com. Season 1 of the TV version of Building the Future is now streaming online at buildingthefutureshow.com. Welcome back to the show. Today we have Engy Fouda. She's an engineer and journalist. Engy, welcome to the show.
Oh, hi, Kevin.
Maybe before we kind of get into exactly what you're doing now, maybe let's cover your background and kind of where you grew up.
Okay. Actually, I grew up in Egypt.
Okay, very cool.
Yes, I'm living in the United States from about 10 years now.
Okay. So what made you kind of move from Egypt to the United States?
Actually, I got married and my husband's working here as an IC consultant, engineer.
Gotcha.
So I had to move with him.
No, that's awesome. So what did you kind of take maybe in university? Did you take that in Egypt? Did you take that in America? I know you're still in school, so you've kind of done a little bit of both, but maybe let's walk us through kind of your university background.
Okay. Actually, I received my bachelor degree and master's degree in computer engineering from Cairo University, and currently I'm pursuing another master's degree in journalism at Harvard Extension School.
Wow.
But
busy.
Actually, I work it for, yes, so busy. Harvard is so hard.
No, I think that's awesome, and it's super impressive. So I'm kind of curious then, how did you kind of get into computer engineering? Because computer engineering and, you know, being in journalism, being a journalist, you know, they're quite different. So what kind of got you passionate about computer engineering?
Actually, since I was a little kid, I was passionate about computers. I started learning computers, I think, at fourth grade.
Okay.
So while it was still mainframes, you know,
sure.
I remember writing my first basic program at a mainframe at the university. So the only place which provided courses at that time in Egypt was Cairo University. So I was just a fourth grader entering the university to write and learn some computers. So it was really fun.
Sure.
Yes. And since then, and my two brothers, actually, my elder and younger brothers, are both computer engineers as well.
Oh, okay. So kind of you've been around it for a long period of time.
Yes.
No, I think that's awesome. So what did you kind of do once you graduated university with computer engineering?
I worked as a teacher assistant.
Okay.
At the American University in Cairo.
Okay.
In the electrical engineering department, and then I joined the German University in Cairo, where I founded the GUC Robotics Research Group.
Okay, very cool.
Yes, I worked for some years about 2 years or 3 years as a computer developer at a petroleum company. And then I decided, no, I have to be academic. So I switched to teaching at the university. And since then, I'm doing some freelance work. But I'm always dedicated somehow to teaching. I give online webinars. Probably as a volunteer work, I teach computer architecture and advanced computer architecture to help students in Egypt to grasp these ideas.
Sure. No, I think that's awesome. So you mentioned kind of teaching and webinars. What kind of stuff do you usually kind of cover? Like, I know you're like a Microsoft certified trainer and whatnot. So is it kind of Microsoft kind of stuff you're teaching, or what exactly are you teaching?
No, actually, the Microsoft courses, I'm Microsoft certified trainer, and
yeah.
I am a charter Microsoft charter member. So I taught at some Microsoft centers.
Right.
So that Microsoft stuff, I have to teach it in the certified centers. I can't teach it outside.
Oh, okay. Got you.
But outside, I teach the basic science for the undergraduates.
Oh, very cool. So you're very busy then.
Yes. So, and I'm currently team lead for the Momkin Group, Engineering for the Blind, Engineering Scholars Incorporation. So yes, I'm too busy.
Yeah, no. So we'll get to kind of your Engineering for the Blind stuff in a second. But I'm curious then, so you moved to America. What kind of decided or what made you decide to kind of go into journalism at Harvard?
Actually, at first I had my baby. I had my daughter.
Sure.
So I had to stay at home for some years. During these years, I wrote some books, some published books.
Sure.
And one of them made a bestseller on Amazon. I was a co-author for that book. And I became an editor-in-chief for an online Arabic monthly magazine. So I found my passion. I really write good and people like my writing. It's some sort of teaching as well, but in writing form.
No, that's so awesome.
Yeah, so I decided, okay, now let me do it professionally. Let me start studying journalism and see how it goes.
No, that's awesome. I think that's really cool. So, yeah, no, I think that's kind of really fascinating to me. So let's kind of maybe get into exactly what you're doing with Engineering for the Blind. Like, I think it's super important, and I love kind of talking about accessibility, and you know, especially as things aren't necessarily move kind of on and offline. I think is kind of what fascinates me about the whole accessibility thing, and you're really kind of in that space. And so do you kind of want to talk about what you're kind of doing in the accessibility kind of blind space?
Yes, sure. It's my main interest.
Sure.
Actually, the Momkin Group started the same. It started by I volunteered to give a webinar with a friend who is a visually impaired person, but he is a fascinating programmer. So we collaborated together to give a webinar with Egypt Scholars Incorporation. Just sharing the idea. Just making the engineers pay attention. Be careful. The visually impaired needs your knowledge. Please start making them devices and programs, because in the Middle East, unfortunately, in the Middle East, the care for the accessibility is very low, and nobody provides Arabic programs, which is the main language. The devices that are imported from outside, it's very expensive for the visually impaired people in Egypt, which is already a poor country. So it's so hard for them to buy these devices, and there are no maintenance for it. Even if they afford it to get it and it got broke, it's done. Nobody maintains it. We did that, and after the webinar, we were surprised by the impact.
Really?
Yes. Many people contacted us to make, okay, let's do it. Let's make a group who cares about engineering and the visually impaired, who dedicates their knowledge and experience to the visually impaired people.
Sure.
So we started like that.
I love that. Like, it was basically like you didn't plan on doing something, and you just got such a good, you know, outreach that you were kind of just went for, right? I think that's awesome, and I think that's super important, right? And I think obviously with the group, you guys are doing really cool stuff, you know, obviously in Egypt like you mentioned, but I think pretty much anywhere in the world, especially as designers and developers, we really need to think about this stuff, right? And that's really why I wanted to have you on the show, because I just kind of want to talk to you about like why it's important, why we should care, you know. And so do you maybe want to talk about kind of exactly that? Like why is it important, and why should people, especially designers and developers, care about when they're doing, you know, kind of software or building kind of physical products in the world?
Yes, actually. To us, it was very cool. Our team, we are about 38 people in that team. We are from all over the world. We never met physically in any place.
That's
awesome. We are always talking online. Our meetings are online. We are from everywhere, literally from everywhere, from Palestine, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Indiana, Washington, California, New York.
but I think that's super awesome to even mention, right? Because the world's so small nowadays that it doesn't even really matter where you are, and you can make like a huge difference globally. No matter where you live, right? And I think the other thing that you just brought up that's really fascinating to me is the fact that you created this whole organization with people across the globe to try to solve like a real problem, right? And bring and almost like promote to the world, this problem that you guys are solving, right? And you're bringing awareness and getting people to think about it. And I think that's super important.
Yes, exactly. And that's what we are trying to do. And every time we talk about it, sharing your dream, every time we share our dream and share our vision, we get more engineers and more visually impaired people interested to join our team, which is really so cool.
No, that's awesome. So what kind of stuff are you guys doing then? Like you mentioned kind of webinars and whatnot, but what exactly are you guys doing?
The Momkin group, Engineering for the Blind, it has many subgroups. One of the subgroups is the visually impaired people. They are the ones who provide us with the ideas, with the problems, and make for us, we make with them the system analysis for any system.
Gotcha.
And they are the ones who provide the testing at the end, and they stay with us throughout the whole process. Okay. Most of them are programmers, even though they are visually impaired, they taught themselves how to use the computers and how to. One of the co-founder of the Mumkin group, the visually impaired person, Wael Zakaria, his name is Wael Zakaria. He actually learned microelectronics and he started to use he once asked for a screwdriver which can talk.
Really?
Yeah, so he can make circuits himself. So it's really fascinating how. They just like that vision. So if anything talks to them, they can do everything that we do.
Interesting.
The other subgroup we have is the devices group. They are the ones who design the devices for the blinds. And it usually it speaks in English and Arabic.
Okay.
The third subgroup is the mentorship. They provide the mentors to the graduation projects of the engineers that are interested in making accessible projects and to the companies. There are very few companies in the Middle East which makes devices and programs for the visually impaired people, and usually they need help.
Okay.
So we provide mentorship to them, we provide testing, we help them in the market survey, we help them in promoting their devices and specifying the prices. Especially the prices, because it differs a lot. You know, if you promoted a certain device in Egypt, the price is entirely different if you promote it in the Gulf area.
Very interesting.
We try to help them. Yes, we try to help them. For example, in Egypt, one of the devices is Hope glasses. It's glasses that help the visually impaired people to know many things. And in Egypt, the visually impaired people said that they can't afford more than 500 Egyptian pounds.
Okay. So what is that in U.S. dollars, just for people that are listening? Roughly?
Roughly it's about $50.
Okay.
While in the Gulf, they said that they can afford till $1,000,
$2,000. Got you. Okay. So quite a range.
Yes, exactly. So they always need help in that. The fourth subgroup we have is the software group, where they make software programs.
Okay.
And the last group is the awareness and the public relations.
Oh, okay, fair enough. No, that makes a lot of sense. So the thing that I've always kind of find fascinating about this whole space is the fact that everything nowadays seems to be getting a lot cheaper, and like what you guys are basically doing, right? And I know smartphones have dropped in price, and certain things and other devices have dropped in price. Like I know I think India has a $5 kind of Android phone now. I know Walmart has a $10 Android phone in the States and whatnot. And so, you know, pretty much most people can afford a smartphone at those prices nowadays. And I think it's only a matter of time before it starts kind of going into other industries. And, you know, as more and more people come online, we need to really think about basically the different kind of accessibility challenges that certain people on the globe have, right? Especially when the first time they might actually access the internet might just be on a phone, right? And we need to think about things about, like screen readers and kind of other things. And it's fascinating to me that you mentioned kind of that screwdriver thing, that if it talks to you, that you could basically do anything, which is really fascinating to me. So I'm kind of curious to dive into other examples, either whether it's in the software space or in the kind of hardware real world space, about things that people should know about, consider when kind of looking at solving some of these kind of challenges.
Yes. Actually, the devices group now are working about a device called the Smart Box. They are working on designing a very small device, just in the size of the mobile, but it has many sensors. Sensors, instead of holding a device for every task, a sensor for a color detection, temperature sensing, knowing the compass, knowing the time, the alarm, many other tasks, you know, and it will be just a very small device where the visually impaired person will just change the sensor and it will tell him the information that he's asking for. Without any help, you know, we are trying to promote the independence so he doesn't ask any people. And one of the very important functions of this smart box is the money detection. Because, this device is not available yet, the money detection for the Middle East currencies. It's available, of course, in Europe and America, but it is not available in the Middle East. And some companies made mobile apps for it, but it is not working very well. And in money, you know,
it needs to work.
It has to be very accurate.
Fair enough.
So this is one of the devices. We finished the first prototype, and we are working on the second prototype for it. About the software, we are developing right now text-to-speech, Arabic text-to-speech. The text-to-speech in English, it's available for free even. Many versions and many companies are providing that. But for the Arabic, unfortunately, not many people are working on that.
Right.
So we are trying to do that. We finished the first prototype, and we are now enhancing the quality because some of the visually impaired people told us, for example, that he feels that it's someone English who is reading Arabic. So Arabic is really hard. It's really hard. It has all the sounds in all the languages and even more. There are some sounds in the Arabic language that is not in any other language.
Sure.
So it's really hard, and even in the writing, it's really hard because we write it from right to left, and it has some special symbols over the letters. So you have to take the symbols and the letters.
Sure.
It's really hard.
Yeah, I can imagine. And just from kind of when we spoke last time, you speak a number of languages, so you understand kind of the challenges going from one to the other, right? And then doing that kind of through software adds it probably adds a handful of other complexities like you just mentioned.
Yes. Actually, I speak English, French, German, and of course Arabic. It's my mother language, mother tongue. So yes, in Arabic, it's really hard and not much research has been done in that area. That's what we are trying to, whenever we are talking to professors in the university, we always tell them, please tackle this problem. Please start working on the character recognition, on the OCR, Arabic OCR. We not yet started Arabic OCR group in our team, but we are planning to do that. because it's a very rich scientific research area.
Sure. So how are you guys funding the Mn group?
Basically, at the beginning, we were funding it ourselves from the team. We are all volunteers, but recently, just from about 10 days, we finished the design for a white cane. We collaborated with a professor in the university in industrial department, and they designed the white cane. Imagine that the white cane is not manufactured in Middle East.
Okay.
Imagine that. So it's a very basic request for the visually impaired people. It's the very basic accessible device ever.
Sure.
So we collaborated with him, a group of we made a contest, organized for the students a contest, and the winning team, we are going to manufacture their design for the white cane.
Oh, very cool.
We wanted to manufacture 1,000. The team members, we could manufacture 30 white canes ourselves.
Okay.
But to make 1,000 white canes to be for free for the visually impaired, it was a little bit high. We wanted about $10,000.
Okay.
So we made a fundraise campaign online, and it was done in 10 days.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yes. Oh, yes. It was very surprising to us. And when we closed the campaign, many people were upset that they couldn't participate. But we told them, okay, let's just try to focus now on the manufacturing, and maybe later on we will do another one.
Sure. No, that makes sense. So where are you guys, how are you guys going about doing manufacturing?
Like, we are going to do it in Egypt.
Okay.
For the first phase, we want to, you know, we are testing on a small area, and then maybe we will go to the other Arab countries around us. But we started at first in Egypt. We are going to manufacture it in Egypt. It's much cheaper.
Okay.
The imported white cane, the cheapest one is about $25.
Okay.
We are going to try to afford it about $5, $10, the manufacturing fees for it.
Sure.
Only costs $5 or $10. So this difference is really huge in Egypt.
Sure. No, that makes a lot of sense. But I think you bring up an interesting point there that we kind of, I think, forget about sometimes being in North America, where, you know, in a lot of cases, sometimes like, oh, what's saving $5? But in a lot of cases, you know, $5 in certain parts of the world is a lot of money, right? Where I'm not saying it's not a lot in North America, but like I think a lot of people, and especially, you know, people that, you know, if you're working in the kind of tech sector, you're probably making decent money, and you probably go to Starbucks and $5 drink is, you know, it happens to you probably on a semi-regular basis, right? And so you don't really think about that. But when you're actually thinking about it in terms of, you know, saving that, especially when it comes to accessibility and some sort of hardware or physical device in the real world in certain countries, like $5 savings is a huge deal, right? And I think what I really wanted to try to stress with having you on the show is like just thinking about these things, because I think we as well, I obviously, like, you live in North America now, but you weren't born in North America, is like, well, I think a lot of people in North America don't really think about people and things outside of North America, right? And I think as the world gets smaller and we talk to people and we partner or we volunteer or we start businesses with people in other parts of the world, we need to really start to think about this stuff, right? And especially if we're selling our software devices in other parts of the world.
Yes, actually in Egypt, some families are living on only $10 a month.
That's $10 US, correct?
Yeah, they earn, yes.
Wow.
They earn $10 and the whole family lives on $10 for one whole month.
So. Wow. So yeah, like saving $5 is huge, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, no.
And if family think about it in another way, if a family consists of five members and all of them are visually impaired people, so the father has to provide five white canes, five devices, five mobiles that has text-to-speech on it, five applications. Every application he's going to buy, it is multiplied by five. So it's really huge cost on a visually impaired person. So if you think about it in from another aspect, wow, this family, probably they are not going to let their kids go to school because they can't afford the white canes for them. Probably they will try to homeschool them, which will make them I'm not sure if they can do that or not, but these visually impaired people, and especially one whole family having visually impaired persons, so they need special care because they need much money.
No, totally. That makes a lot of sense. So I'm curious then, so you get, once you guys are done, you got your 1,000 white canes, how do you go about distributing them to people? Do you guys have some people kind of in Egypt that can hand these out, or how does that process even work?
Yes, actually, most of the members of the Momkin group were already volunteers in another organization in Egypt, which is called Resala.
Okay.
Resala means message in English.
Okay.
So,
got you.
This organization, we actually work, we are going to distribute the white canes through them. We are going to provide they have already many visually impaired activities and the groups inside this organization. So they are going to help us in distributing the white canes.
I got you. So how long roughly will it take you to make 1,000 of the canes?
I think a couple of months.
Okay, so that's not too bad, especially in kind of manufacturing terms.
And we are not going only to provide the white canes.
Okay.
We are going to provide as well training on using the white canes. Because we discovered in Upper Egypt that when we send the prototypes for testing, we discovered that many people in the Upper Egypt, they don't even hear about the white cane. They don't know.
Really?
Because it is not afford, and if it's there, it's too expensive for them to buy it. So
I got you.
Many
okay.
people, they don't know it. So when we went to a school for the visually impaired kids, one of the teachers told us, I know how to use it. If you can afford it, I can train my students on using it. But it has to be afforded first.
Yeah, no, fair.
So yes, it's a big problem.
So how, like... This may sound like a stupid question, but how do you train somebody? Like, what are you showing them when you're training them?
Actually, the white canes, it differs. It has many types.
Okay.
The length of the white cane depends on the height of the person.
Oh, so interesting. I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. They usually use it if he's going to step his left foot, then he has to check the place he's going to locate his foot first before putting his foot on it. And with the it has to be hollow from inside, so he feels in his hand what he's going to step on. Is it going to have a mud? Is it a rocky? Is it a hard street, soft street? What is the material that he's going to step on it so he doesn't slip?
Sure. No, that makes a lot of sense.
So this needs training, and the stairs, of course, it needs a big training to use the white cane for step down and up the stairs.
Okay, makes sense.
And in the streets, actually, the training mainly at first they teach them how to use it.
Okay.
Before walking inside a closed place, and then outside in the streets where it's hazard environment, anything can happen. So he has to check before it and to teach them how to hear the people around them. In Egypt, there is no traffic laws enforced, not like the North America. So it's very dangerous to cross the street.
Sure.
So they need special training for that.
Sure. Yeah, no, that's actually, this is quite fascinating to me. I love that this whole space and kind of learning about this, because like a lot of the stuff we just take for granted, right?
Yes. And even in Europe and in the crowded places like New York City, you will find that traffic lights actually speaks. It says, now it's red light, now it's safe to cross.
Okay.
In Egypt, no, we don't have such traffic lights.
Right, okay. So So I guess what's kind of the future of the Mokin Group?
This is a hard question, you know.
Because you guys are in so many different spaces, right? So, like, do you guys have kind of, like, you mentioned that you'll probably do another run and campaign to build more canes, but and you're doing some stuff on the software space, but is there any kind of other physical products that you guys are looking at building? I know you mentioned color detection and stuff like that. Is there anything else that's coming down the pipeline, or is it kind of still too early and you got too much on the plate to kind of decide?
Actually, we decide everything step by step.
Okay.
Every phase, when we are done with that phase, we start looking for other problems to solve. So currently, we are looking for providing the cooking utensils for the blind women, because we discovered that the burning rates for the women is really high in the kitchen.
Oh,
so we try to this will be our next project, to provide the cooking utensils that speaks to the women.
Okay.
And educational devices, you know, two hours of Momkin group went to the California blind school, and they found really very cool devices that they use there.
Okay.
So we hope we can manufacture something similar to the blind schools in Egypt.
That's really cool, and it's interesting. It kind of gets thinking about all the different things that we just do that we don't think about, that, you know, yeah, you obviously you could burn yourself pretty easily, right? And solving those kind of problems for people, I think we're kind of at, in some cases, I think we're kind of at the beginning of the tech revolution, where you can almost apply technology to almost anything that hasn't had technology applied to it. And what I mean by that is, like you said, like a talking screwdriver, you might not have been able to do that a few decades ago, but now it's pretty affordable. You could probably do it pretty cheap. You could probably sync it to a phone. So, you know, and you could probably have it almost even get software updates, for lack of a better term of that, right?
Exactly. Where, yes. And right. For the medicines as well. We thought many blind people actually complained about that they can't recognize their medicines.
They need
some Braille stickers to be sticked over the medicine box, so they know when to take it and how to take it. So we are still looking in this system. We didn't decide yet to start doing it, but we are still looking for solutions for this problem.
Sure. No, that makes a lot of sense. So I'm curious then, you said you've had quite a bit of interest from people kind of wanting to be part of the group. How do people that are interested kind of go about being a part of it?
Actually, in Egypt, the scholars itself, we have a hiring process. They okay. just apply online on the website.
Okay, what's the website, then, just for people listening?
Oh, yes, it's egyptscholars.org, egyptscholars.org.
Okay, perfect.
Yes, they apply online.
Okay.
And then the HR contact us with the interested candidates, and we talk with them. We see his qualifications, and according to his resume, I direct him to the suitable subgroup.
Gotcha.
And the subgroup team lead makes an interview with him, and the process follows.
Okay. And if I want to volunteer, is it the same process, or how do I go about doing that?
Yes, yes, of course. I'd be so happy to hire you, Kevin.
No, but even just people listening, if they're interested in kind of contributing in some way too, like how do they go about, become a part of this, right? If they're in a different part of the world or whatnot.
Oh yeah, they usually just send us an email at Momkin, okay. Momken at egyptscholars.org.
Okay.
Or any member of the team. They just send an email to any member of the team or to the website, to the Facebook page.
I got you. Okay. And I'll post these links in kind of the show notes. So, you know, hopefully some listeners out there reach out to you guys, because I think what you guys are doing is super important and you know, much needed. I think what I like about kind of what you guys are doing is you're basically a startup, right? You have a bunch of volunteers. You guys are building physical and digital products that solve real problems in, you know, kind of globally, really. Like, what you guys are doing could be used pretty much anywhere, right? There's people in need of this stuff on a global scale. You know, obviously, in Egypt and other parts of the world, I think it makes a lot of sense, especially in places where this stuff isn't as common as it is in North America, right? And so,
yes,
I think it makes a lot of sense. And if anybody's out there, either check out the website or check out the show website, or, you know, reach out to me personally and I can kind of pass you along to you guys, right? Because
I think
it makes a lot of sense, and I think it's super important. And I think even just getting people to think about accessibility for different types of people when they're building physical or digital products, right? Because I've been thinking about it, you know, over my career, but, you know, sometimes sadly it's not in the budget, right? Or it's not the target market. But I think as more and more people come on online, we need to think about these things, because potentially you could be limiting a bunch of users, right?
Yes.
Just by not considering certain things. And I get that you might not need to cover every possible combination, but even if you just start thinking about this or put it on your software roadmap, I think makes a lot of sense, right? And you can gain a lot of users just that way, right?
Yeah, sure. Yes, of course. And actually, it's worth mentioning that Egypt Scholars is a nonprofit organization. We are registered in California, USA.
Okay.
This is the formal registration, you know, and we are all volunteers. And that's why when we made the fundraising campaign, we decided to offer these canes, white canes, for free to the visually impaired people in Egypt. So, yes, we are working with the same methodology of any startup company, and we are really following these rigid, you know, rigid procedures. We always do market survey. We always do quality assurance. We always have the feedback from the users and the customers. We follow the same way professionally, but we try to make it for free and afford it for free for the visually impaired people.
Sure. No, I think that's awesome. But sadly, we're kind of running out of time. So maybe do you want to close the show with promoting anything that you want to mention personally, or about kind of the Mumkin group again, and maybe where people can find you guys online again?
Yes, of course. Actually, we have a Facebook page. It has Mumkin, M-O-M-K-E-N, on the Facebook. And our website is Egypt Scholars, EGYPTSCHOLARS.org. Actually, the organization, it has many projects.
Sure.
Mumkin Group is only one project from it.
Gotcha.
The organization is really making some fascinating other projects. We are the only group up till now caring about the accessibility. I wish that we have another one for the deaf people. This will be awesome. And we're always calling for volunteers. So it will be really very useful if someone would like to donate not only money, but donate the experience and the knowledge.
Sure.
You know, this is the new volunteering aspect that we are asking for.
No, I think that's awesome. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time out of your very, very busy schedule with school and volunteering and this project and your magazine and kind of everything else you're involved in, and just being kind of a mother and a wife. And
Oh, yes. Actually, I just finished a Lego Mindstorm robot with my daughter.
Sure. No, that's awesome. So, but yeah, like, thanks again for doing this. I really appreciate
it.
Thank you. I look forward to kind of keeping in touch with you and kind of following your guys' journey.
Oh, thanks, Gavin, so much. It's really an honor to me to be a guest on your show. I'm really so glad for that. And thank you for this opportunity and for this time. I love your show. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. And we'll talk soon.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Thanks for listening. The music for the show is done by Electric Mantra. You can check them out at electricmantra.com. And keep building the future.